Joining us for more is Amro's chief economist, Dr. Ho-Yi Kor. Hi, sir. Thank you so much for joining us. Welcome to Market Edge.
Thanks, Mimi.
Okay, doctor, the consensus is, at least for most of the think tanks we talked to, is that starting next year, the Philippines will see below average growth, below our usual 6%. But clearly, Amro, you guys don't think so. In fact, you're expecting growth to further pick up to 6.5% in 2024. Don't you think you're overestimating the Philippines? What are you seeing?
Well, we are very happy that Philippines is outperforming the other countries in the region. It has outperformed, I think, most analysts' expectation. Last year's growth was very strong at 7.6%. And this year, I think most of the other ASEAN economies have slowed down. Well, Philippines has also slowed down, but it is actually doing much better than expected. But a lot of that depends on is due to the structure of the economy. The Philippines is a much more of a service economy, and has not been affected as much by the slowdown in manufacturing goods exports. So it's able to sustain its momentum of recovery, and it's mostly driven by domestic demand. So we are very optimistic that growth will be able to reach 6.2% this year, and even higher next year, because we expect the global economy to recover somewhat next year.
Dr. Ho-Yi Kor, is this high growth? Is this simply high growth, or is it high quality growth?
I think it's in the short term, I think we should be happy that it's high growth. And it's high quality growth only in the sense that it's supported by, you know, a very strong labor market, and also by strong remittances from abroad. So in that sense, the economy is doing well, but I think one reason why inflation has stayed high is partly because growth is very strong. And so there's a demand component to the growth. We know that the Philippines has suffered from a lot of supply shocks last year, and notwithstanding that, and that's one of the reasons why inflation is high. But the other reason is because demand has been quite strong in the Philippines.
All right. Now, I wanted to get your opinion and to help us put this in context, to briefly go over ASEAN Plus 3. Some of the countries that we always look to whenever we compare growth with the Philippines is Vietnam. Vietnam, what's happening to Vietnam? It got a very big downgrade. Is this purely a manufacturing hit from weak demand?
It's mostly manufacturing hit, you know. As you know, Vietnam has emerged as one of the manufacturing powerhouse in the region. It received a lot of investment from abroad, especially from Korea, and has become, you know, the center for producing the smartphone. So unfortunately, you know, the semiconductor industry is going through a downturn, a cyclical downturn, and that's the main reason why the Vietnam has been hit badly. But it's still attracting a lot of investment. This is a temporary problem. Also has some problem in the construction sector. So overall, we downgrade growth this year to 4.4%, but we expect growth to rebound quite strongly next year, though.
Okay, that's 4.4 from an 8% growth the year before. What about Thailand? You're expecting Thailand to grow 3.9%. Is this going to be tourism driven?
That's correct. Thailand has been lagging behind the recovery of the other countries, unfortunately. But this year, last year was a good year because the economy opened up and tourism recovered. It is still in the process of recovering. So this year, I think they expect the tourism to recover back to about 70-80% of pre-pandemic level. So it will continue to recover, and that's one of the driver of growth for Thailand. So we're very happy to see that, you know, the growth has finally recovered to 3.9%, and we think that next year you'll be even stronger at 4%.
And finally, Dr. Ho-Yi Kor, China. It's keeping its 5.5% growth. I guess the question there is China as important to the region's health as it was 5 to 10 years ago, or have economies decoupled enough?
China is very important to the region because it's part of the regional supply chain. Many of the economies here produce intermediate products that feeds into the manufacturing production in China mm-hmm. and get re-exported to the US. So if you look at the imports of China from the region, it's the number one trading partner for many of the countries, but most of that is in intermediate goods exports. And the reason why, you know, the region has not benefited as much from the recovery in China is also because of that. Much of the final demand comes from the US and Europe. So because Europe and the US are going in weakening because of the, especially in the goods sector, there's a strong headwind and it has not benefited the export sector in the region.
So we're beating Vietnam, we're beating Thailand, we're beating China in terms of growth rates, but they're still much bigger economies. We seem to be saying all the right things. We seem to be showing the best grades. But you know what? It seems that investors are not buying it. Just look at our FDIs. We're far from the FDIs these countries are getting. Why do you think so? What should we do to convince foreign investors, hey, it's time to bet on the Philippines?
Well, Philippines has chosen a somewhat different approach from the other countries in the region, as you noted. But we have looked at the investment number into the Philippines, and it's about sustained around 8 to 10%, 10 billion a year. I think that can go up in the coming years because of several factors. One is that I think you're spending a lot more on infrastructure now, and that has always been one of the weaknesses of the Philippines. And improvement in infrastructure will help to crowd in foreign investment from abroad. The other reason is I think, you know, Philippines has taken some steps to open up the economy more. I think the services sector was relatively closed until recently, but there are several legislation now going through, you know, your Congress, which will open up the economy more. And finally, the digitalization, I think that is accelerated in the Philippines. So you need to continue to build the digital infrastructure and crowd in investment into the service, into the digital services. And so you have the BPO, and you now need to move to the KPO, which is the knowledge processing outsourcing, and that will give a boost to the economy as well. So I think, you know, you need to be patient and continue to build up the infrastructure and the framework to support the FDI inflows.
All right, but it's not just the infrastructure, it's also the people. Do you think that the strength of the Philippine consumer can be depended on to avoid any risk of a slowdown over the next 12 to 24 months? I mean, we know consumers are probably not spending with abandon, but they are spending, they're hanging on. Do we have the resources, you know, the good jobs, stable market for jobs, the savings to sustain that, to keep the consumer strong?
Well, one of the strengths of the Philippines is, of course, the remittances, which has been very stable and kept growing even during the pandemic and last year. And that is helped to support domestic consumption. So, but you know, what it also means is that Philippines is exporting a lot of skilled labor abroad. Right? So when you go to the Philippines, there's a shortage of skilled labor. So I think the government can do more to, you know, to upgrade the skill, the labor force in order to attract more investment into the Philippines. I think the BPO has been relatively successful because it offers a relatively a good wages, and also it employs the graduates from the colleges. And so those are the kind of industry that I think Philippines will try to build, and also to keep the skilled labor force within the economy.
All right. On that note, Dr. Hoey Kor, thank you so much for joining us this morning. It was a pleasure speaking with you, sir. See you soon.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.